So welcome, everybody. This talk will be about how you can use Groovy nowadays. If you want to know how you can Groovy in the future, you have to go to the other one. That's the Groovy 2.5 and further on introduction. A little bit about myself. My complete name is Hubert Alexander Kleinicking, and also known as mrhaki. I write blog posts about Groovy, Gradle, Spock, Eskadoctor, anything that I can use in my projects in the daily life. And I want to learn about is also worth writing about, I think so. I work at a company called JDrift in the Netherlands, basically as a contractor and a consultant. So this talk will be a lot of Groovy stuff that's available, which you might not use in your everyday life. And also for preparing these kind of talks, I always stumble upon blog posts I had written before. So I want to show a lot of those things here today. And to have a bit of a schedule and some kind of categorizations, we're going to see some of the extra functions and methods that are available for string manipulation in Groovy. Of course, collection API, there's a lot of methods in the collection API available to work with lists and maps and whatever in an easy way. Also, we're going to see how we can use Groovy and Java 8 together. So, for example, the stream API introduced in Java 8, we can still use it in our Groovy code I will show you how you can do it. Another thing, if you're writing Groovy code and especially Groovy scripts, there's a grep annotation and that allows you to download dependencies for a script without any build system like Maven, Ent, or Gradle, for example. And there are different ways to define how you do your dependency downloading, and also I will show you how you can change that. There are a lot of AST transformations in Groovy, and I will show you some of them as well, and how you can customize them to make them work for yourself. And at the end, there's some miscellaneous stuff if we have time left and things I can show. So this is the end of the slides. Let's go to some code. So the first thing I want to show is if we work with strings. So let's create a simple script. Is this readable for everybody? Yeah, okay, nice. It's called presentation mode, so it should be. So, for example, if we define a string value in Groovy, it's not that difficult to do. One of the things that are added to strings is a capitalized function. And, well, then I should not start with a capital. Let's do it like this. And when I run my code, let's do a print line for this one. It should capitalize the first letter of my string value. You can see here at the bottom the output, and that works. And if you can capitalize a string value, why should we not be able to uncapitalize the same string value as well? So we have this capitalize method available for strings, but also uncapitalize, which was introduced later in Groovy. And when I run this code, it should now have this lowercase h at the beginning of the sentence, so that works. If you want to have string values and you want to encode them, for example, hexadecimal values or base 64 encoding, it's also possible to do in Groovy quite easily. So we have this string s, and let's say I want to do encode the hexadecimal value for that one. And also, for the same thing, let's do print line and encode base 64 for that. Let's run it, and it should show the different values here at the bottom. So very easy way that Groovy makes it possible to handle those kind of string values. And instead of encoding, you can also decode the same values back in strings if you want to. Also, if you have these string values, so let's just make a very simple one and do create conf. There's text translation available in strings in Groovy, which is used by the tr method, which is not used that much, but it can be quite useful. And it actually takes two arguments. It takes the first argument, which is basically the characters you want to be replaced, and the second argument is the replacement character itself. So in this case, I want to replace the grade conf, the G, R, and the C, lowercase to capitals. So I can just simply give this pattern. So the characters G, R, and C should be replaced by the capital versions. If I run this, it's now replaced correctly. So now I have this correct grade conf way of saying that we're here. It's another way to define something is, let's say we have this as well. We can have ranges. So any letters, for example, between A and K should be uppercased. Could also be possible. So it looks a bit like a regular expression, but it's not. It has its own parsing mechanism itself, this TR function, but still it works, and we have a nice way to do this. Another way to have character replacements is the function collect replacements that takes a closure. So, for example, there's print line collect replacements, and there we can have our own functions available as well. So let's say I make a new string. It's called, well, let's call it great, and then say Groovy is great. And I want to replace this zeros with O's and the eights with the let's EAT, then apply it on the correct variable. Ooh. Come message, there it is. So this closure takes an argument, which is basically the character I have here. So I can now do, for example, say if character is O, return the O. If the character is 8, returns 8. And otherwise, just return null. So what this closure does, if the null is returned, it will just not replace the character. If it's not null, it will replace the character. So it's done print lines. Let's run this. And here at the bottom, you know, oh, ah. I should replace it correctly, otherwise it will not work. It still does not work. Why is it not working? Thank you. That should hopefully do the trick. Yeah, thanks. I missed a part for it, so that's okay. So different ways to change values in the string that are available in Groovy. Also, let's take a look at some of the collection API stuff that's available. So I will make a new script called collections. And for example, just create a simple list. So I have this list of string values. Just a couple of the frameworks and the language that we use, hopefully, in the daily life, if we're allowed to. To get elements from this list is quite easy, but also to get the first element of the list, there's always this first method. To get the last element of the list, there's a last method available. Quite easy to do. But there's also, for example, a head method available. So to get the first element, can be done as well. And if there's a head, there's also a tail version. And let's print out to see if it still works. So at the bottom we're gonna see, there we go, the output of the calls we made. But what if we want to have the first elements but not the last one? That's also possible in Groovy. They have a lot of things there. And one of the methods added was init. The init method will return the first two elements, in this case because we have three elements in my list. So when I run this, it should return Groovy and Gradle, so the first elements, and then actually to get the last one, I could just use list.last. So the reverse of head and tail basically is init and last in this case. That can be used quite easily. Also, if you have a list of elements, you want to have only the first two, for example, but you're not sure how big the list will be. It can be something you do in your everyday programming. So there's this take method, which takes an argument, which is the numbers of elements you want from this list. So I say, let's take two elements from this list, or I want to have 10 elements from this list. I should not get an exception, it should get me back the results I expect. If I want to have take two from a list of three elements, it should give back my two elements, and that works. And when I do take 10, although there are not 10 elements in my list, it's only three, it does not give an exception, but gives me back the three elements that are in the list. So without exceptions, I can still have run this code quite easily. It's very useful, for example, if you have top 10 thing in your website. You can just say take 10, and maybe the list is longer or shorter than 10 elements, but you don't have to take that into account. That's done for you automatically by the take method. So this is just taking an element, and if you can take something from the start, you can also drop something. So in this case, I want to drop two elements, and I want to have the last element in this case. Just remove it, otherwise it clutters up my output. So by using the drop method, I'm dropping the first two elements and I'm getting the third one in this case. Also, when I do drop 10, it should give me back an empty list, although I have only three elements. So here you notice no exceptions, but just the result I can work with, but the result is also correct. This is just by numbering and indexing, basically. So the number of elements I want to return, but also taking with conditions is also possible. So there's a take while and there's a drop while method available. So I can have a condition, let's say, if the size of the string in this case is bigger than, it's all the same, I guess, right? So it's 6. Wow. Let's put one in between. Spock is less, right? There you go. So if the size is bigger than 5, it should return, take the elements. So in this case, I expect it to only return Groovy because that's the one that's bigger than 5 characters long as Spock is not. So let's see if that works. Yeah, it returns Groovy in this case. And also, there's the drop while, if there's a take while. And it gives me back Spock, Cradle, and Grills because the first element is bigger than 5. So yeah, it also is correct. If you have, for example, let's say we have a certain range of numbers. Let's do 2 to 10 and also add some letters to it. Check. It kind of reflects a deck of cards, actually. So let's get card numbers and let's also give. So we have clubs, diamonds, hearts, and spades. And I want to turn this into a new collection with actually a combination of all these elements, which is not that difficult to do. So we can have, in this case, colors and card numbers and the combinations. Let's run it. And this should actually combine all the elements of the two collections. And now we have a full set of cards here. So we have the club, number 2, the diamonds 2, the hearts 2, and if you go on and on and on, you can see we now have a complete set of cards. So by using this extra function on the collection API, it's really easy to make a bigger collection out of something. But also we can have a zip-like function. If you do functional programming, Rx, Java, and stuff like that, there's always something, a zip function, to combine two collections with the same size and then zip them together, actually. And it's called transpose in Groovy. So we have the same kind of method, but it's differently named. So let's say we have another list here. So let's do, well, some letters. And let's start. And we have some upper letters. And I can zip those together as well. So I have letters and the upper collection and do transpose on it. And it should give me back a new collection. In this case, all the element, the first element of the letters collection and the first element of the upper collection is packed together. The B and the Y and the C and the X are also together. So if you have need of a zip-like function, it's there in Groovy, but it's named differently. So that's nice to know. Also, if we have, for example, let's remove it. So let's make a range of the alphabet, quite easily done using the ranges. So this should give me back all the letters of the alphabet. So we have now this new collection, and each element is a letter of the alphabet. If we want to have indexes of this collection, so we have alphabet, there's an indexes property, which gives you back all the indexes, and that should be from 0 up to 25. Using the transpose function we saw earlier, we can, for example, zip those together, and we have for each letter the place of it in the alphabet quite easily. Instead of using indices, we have also other functions to do the same thing. A lot of the functional things are there. So we have also with index. We can run that. And then we already have this zipped result available automatically. So with index does that for us. So we now know that the A letter A is the first zero position in the alphabet. And that's not really what we want if we want to reason about it. It should actually start at 1 instead of 0. So we have this extra argument of the with index function. Just give it 1. There we go. And now it starts at 1. So quite easily we have now this. We can have kind of secret letters and then translate them and have numbers instead of letters, for example. But we can also do something else as well to translate this instead of, now we have this list where each item in the list is also a list. So A, 1 is another list item, B, 2 is another list item. We can also have the indexed method, which returns a map. And the key of the map is the index value, and the value is actually the alphabet letter. Which is quite nice. And also here we want to start with 1. So let's run this. Now we have a complete list which says, okay, position 1, we have letter A, and up until the end, that still works. So a lot of different ways to actually achieve the same thing, and that's something you can see in Groovy quite a lot. If you want to do something, there's a lot of ways to do the same, to achieve it quite easily, actually. What I also want to show is actually sorting in a collection. So for example, I have this user class which has a name and it's an email. And let's give this a toString because we want to show some information about it. Also, I like to give it an ID, why not? Then let's say I want to have a list of users. So there's new user which has ID 1, that's a username. Let's mrhaki and has an email address which is localhost, and then add another user as well. So new user ID 2. That's a username. That's my first name, and then the email will be user at localhost. Let's turn this also into an immutable list. So into immutable. It should be valid. Let's see if this runs. S immutable, right. Yeah, that's the correct one. So this should still compile. So now I have a list, which is an immutable list. And I want to do some sorting on it. And for example, I can add a sortable annotation to my class. So this is one of these HD transformations that are available, and that will add automatically some methods to my class. And it will implement the compareTo interface, it will implement the compareTo method, and now I can use it in, for example, a sorting situation. And the ordering of my properties is important here, because it will first order sort on ID. If that IDs are the same, it will do it on username and otherwise on email. So it will use all the things here. But still, of course, we can customize it. There's an includes and excludes option for this annotation, the sortable annotation. So you can say certain fields need to be included for the comparison. Otherwise, certain fields can be excluded. So let's do a very naive sort, because there's always a sort method on a collection. It has been in Groovy for a very long time. Don't show any spoilers. So let's see if we can sort it. And now it says unsupported operation. Why? Because the sort method, which was in the early Groovy versions, changes my original list. So it's really a sort method with side effects. This is really a bad thing. So they added a certain an extra argument. So I can say sort false, which means give me back a new collection instead of the mutated collection. So now it should give me back the correct sorting. So that works. But there's also a new sort method available. It's called toSorted, which automatically has the same behavior actually as the sort method with the false argument. So this works out the box correctly, and it creates a new list instead of transforming my old list and the old values, luckily. So the toSorted method has options to specify, for example, a comparator or a closure. So for example, I want to sort on the let's say the email. So I get two items, and I can say the email, nice spaceship operator for the comparator, and then it should be sorted on email, which of course is true. Let's just make it a bit more interesting. So now the second user should be the first in the list. Yep, that works. But also, by adding this sortable annotation, I also have now a static method in my user class, which is generated actually by this annotation, which says user comparator by email. And also comparator by username, and a comparator by ID is generated. But in this case, I want to have a comparator for email. So let's run, and we have the same effect as what we had with disclosure. I don't know why, but IntelliJ does not recognize it as a method that's really valid, but still it works, so that's a nice thing. This works for to sort it, but there's also uniqueness available. So you have this unique method, just like the sort method for collections, which has also this false option, just like the sort option. And if we have sort and to sorted, then we have also a to unique, and that has the same characteristics as to sort it. So I can pass either a closure to compare values for uniqueness, or I can use, for example, a generated comparator by the sortable annotation to get the same thing. Also, if you're working with collection API and you want to have a stack implementation, there's nice methods available as well. We can say list pop, and then we get to the last element of the list, actually. Let's make a different list, because I probably had a range. Yeah, so the last element is 4 in this case. And I can also push back a new value on it. So with the pop and push methods available on list, the list API, which is not available in Java, we can have simple stack implementation quite easily with a simple list underneath, actually. Another thing I want to show is, let's say we have a message that says, Groovy is great, just because it is. And then we can swap elements in the collection using the swap method. So I can able to swap, for example, the second element for the first, and then the first element for that one. And then probably can say, it should say something like, there we go. And of course, it should be a nice sentence. Just add the join method. And great, Groovy is. No, that's of course true. Also, if we work with Groovy, and especially if you're doing Java 8, and you want to, for example, use the Streams API that was introduced in Groovy in Java 8, and all the lambda expressions that were introduced. There is a new project in the Groovy. It's now, I don't know which version, 2.5, 2.6, or 3, whatever, but it's the parrot parser. And the parrot parser really allows us to have Java 8-like constructs, like lambda expressions, in our Groovy code, but still, it's not what we can use today. But there are ways around it, because every lambda expression is also can be implemented using a closure in Groovy. So if you want to use this, for example, the Java 8 Stream API, instead of a lambda expression, just use a closure for that one. So let's see how that works. Let's call it Java, just as a simple, I want to also show another annotation. Immutable, not that one. So there's a transformation. Let's say I have this nice, it's also a user class in my talks, which is, let's create a new list of users. And let's say I have two names. I want to collect on it and say new user, username. So just from this list of strings, I want to create new user objects with values. Then I want to have a result. And then I want to use this stream API from Java, because a lot of people are talking about it. Next year, I want to filter on it, which takes a predicate. I also want to use the map method, which takes a function. At the end, it should be able to do collect and have a result which I can print. So actually, all these take either an, we could implement a filter via an anonymous interface, but we can also use closures for it instead of lambda expression or anonymous interfaces. So we have this user object, and if the user dot username dot size, let's do different starts with the letter H, it should be passed on. And I want to also do this in uppercase, and I want to use method references for it. So let's say I have this method that takes, let's call it upper, it takes a user object, and it actually returns the username to uppercase. So it does actually two things. My user object, the username is returned as a string, let's make it explicit here, and the string value is uppercase. This does not work, but we have also already, and it was a long time in Groovy, the map method takes a closure as an argument as well, and we can turn methods into closures quite easily using dot ampersand upper. So we have this kind of method references you have in Java 8, and then we actually use this trick of turning methods into closures to have the same effect. So let's run, and it should give me back a good result. So, still using Java 8 API things, which normally would require lambda expressions, I can still have this method references by turning those methods into closures or just simply use a closure implementation here. Which leads me to the constructor reference. So in Java 8, if you want to have a new user, actually it could be something like this. But this is not a valid syntax yet for Groovy, but we can have a trick for that as well. There is this invoke constructor on the meta class. So we're actually tricking now the invoke constructor method into a closure, and we kind of have the same thing as the guys have in Java, actually. Ah, what's wrong? This should work. Thank you. This should be it. It's now an argument to the method collect. Let's run it again. And now it works. So that's just another way to deal with it, actually. Another thing I want to show is if you write Groovy scripts that have dependencies on external libraries, which are not in the class path by default, we can use grep annotation. So let's go to the new Groovy script. Let's call it grep. Let's say I want to use something from Apache Commons. So I can just use the grep annotation, and just if you're used to defining dependencies in Gradle, we have exactly the same kind of syntax here. So lang 3, I think it's version 3.4, I guess. Nice thing, if you're using IntelliJ, just press Alt-Enter on this grep annotation, and it grabs the artifacts for me. If I want to execute the script from the command line, then it will be the executed from the command line. What I want to introduce here is the system utils class from Commons 3, and also there's the system utils Java 1.8 constant. That should be it. So now I can really use this in my code. So let's say if system utils is Java version at least, so let's do it a bit nicer as Java 8. I can say print line running else do something else. So now I'm executing this, and it should automatically. That's probably needing the complete package name here. Let's run it again. Yeah, Favre. Oh. Let's do, probably my import is wrong. This should work. Yep, now it works. Sorry for the wrong import, but at least it shows that although I don't have the dependency here, it's automatically grabbed for me. The thing is, even if you run this from the command line, you don't get a lot of feedback that the dependency is being downloaded. And to get that kind of feedback, you have to specify certain system properties to a Groovy. So when we run the script and want to see that something is being fetched, for example, I have some virtual machine properties I can set. One of them is the option groovy.grape.report downloads is true. So now it will give me some information that certain things are downloaded or not. Maybe if it's downloaded already, it will be on your computer and it will not be downloaded again. And also there's an extra property that's called IV message logger level, which takes a numeric value. It could be either 0, which means only errors are shown, or you use the value 4. There will be a lot of noise while the logging is or the downloading is happening, or any other information that needs to be shown. So let's run the script again, and hopefully it will show some more information. Well, there we go. So it shows actually what it's trying to do, preparing to download stuff, looking for dependencies, and if you go down, you will see it's not required because I already downloaded it before. I run the script previously here. And then at least you get some more information about when things are wrong, and that can be useful, otherwise it's really quiet, the grep annotation. Also, if you're doing handling dependencies, especially using the grep annotation, all dependencies are fetched transitive. So if this commons lang la dependency should also have dependencies on other stuff as well, that would be downloaded. And if we don't want that, there's also a possibility, of course, there's grep exclude annotation, where you can just say, okay, don't want those transitive stuff also downloaded here. The final thing I want to show about using grep, it's now downloaded in my use directory. So there's a cache actually of all downloaded dependencies. But if I want to have those dependencies local to my project, I can also use another system property. And that one is called grape.root. So, and I want to store it in a lib folder of my current project, for example. Let's run again. And it should be, yeah, there it is. So at the current location, which is my source directory, now I have a lib folder which has a grapes folder, and then the dependency in the jar files are stored there. So it's quite an easy way to handle that as well. I also want to show some of the other AST transformations available. And once you probably use quite a lot, but they have a lot of parameters you can customize as well. First of all, I want to work with SL4J, and therefore I first need to download the dependency for an implementation for it. So there's, for example, lockback, the classic artifact, and that's one that should be the correct version now. Grep is with a B. So grep the artifacts, and now I should be able to say, okay, for example, I have a class, let's use another one here. So there's a topic and there's a location for this talk, and I want to have logging for it. So by just applying this SO4J annotation, I think most people already know about it, but there are different frameworks like log4j2, log4j, the default Java util logging annotations are available. So there's also log and there's log4j2, for example. In this case, I'm using SO4J. Which adds automatically to the generated class file a log property, which I can use in my code. So, for example, I can say show location, and there's this log created by SO4J. That's what IntelliJ tells me already. And there's info and say show location, for example. But the name of this logger variable is fixed in this case, but of course, nothing should be fixed, I should be able to change it. So I can also say, instead of log, I want to have it in capitals, or say that's logger. And also, for example, I can change the category in which is actually the logger output, which I can use to... Oh, then, of course, it's now called differently. Let's run this. Then let's do a version of the talk. Because otherwise I will not be printing anything. So there's Groovy Goodness and location. It's here. So let's run this. So it now shows here my log message actually, and you notice it's sort of level logging levels info because that's what I specified here, but also it's now using grateconf.au as the category of my log message. Another thing I want to show is creating new objects is normally done using new followed by the class name. There's also something called a newify annotation in Groovy, which allows you to have a different way of creating object instances actually. Newify allows me to specify which classes need different syntax. So instead of using new, I can just say talk and leave out the new part. So this is a bit Python-y like way of creating objects, and still works. Or if you come from a Ruby background, there's also a new method now available you can use to create an object. So just by applying this newify annotation, we have different ways now to create objects and use it. Also, the toString annotation is something we can add quite easily to a class, and that adds for us a default toString implementation. But also here, we have a lot of parameters we can use. For example, which kind of fields do we want to have in this toString implementation? We can exclude fields, we can include fields. We could say if this is part of a hierarchy of classes, do we include superclasses and properties as well? What I also try to do is include names, because that's always nice to have that in output. The package could be false, for example. And also, if this class, if you know it's immutable, in this case it's not, but it could be, there's also cache available. So you can say cache is true, which means the method value, the value for the string is cached. So the first time when you invoke the string, it will generate the value, and the second time it does not have to be generated again because, well, none of the values can change for an immutable class. So that makes it a bit faster. So when I now do the toString, it should show me the names of the properties. So that's topic, followed by colon, followed by the value and location, and it does not include any package information because it's not in a package, but just to make sure that it works, I can edit. Grateconf. Let's run this. And when I change this to true, it should show me grateconf.talk and the toString implementation. So here it is. Now it's showing. So there are different ways to customize these annotations by providing those options via the annotation parameters, actually. Also, if you have certain classes you want to clone, normally in Java, you have to implement the clonable interface, implement the clone method to make sure things can be cloned. In Groovy, there is this auto-clone transformation that does that stuff for you automatically. So just by applying an auto-clone annotation, I can now have my talk here, and I can create a new talk as a clone. And it just works. So the default way to implement the clone method by using this auto-clone annotation, it invokes superclone on the object class, because every class we actually write here officially extends object. We don't have to type it, but it does to make it work. So let's see if we do print line, should have the same object, and I removed my toString. Let's put it back. So it should have the same values for the properties. So that works. We can also let another implementation of the clone method be generated instead of a default one where the superclone method is invoked. So we have this parameters here, which one of them is style. So there's an autoclone style. We have different options here. There's also, for example, a simple one. Then the implementation of the clone method will first invoke the constructor of the talk class and then assign properties. And there's also a copy constructor, which adds a new constructor to my class, which is of a protected visibility, which takes in another talk object and then uses that to do the cloning. So you have different options to work with it. And especially the copy constructor one can be useful if you have an immutable class where actually only property values can be set in a constructor. So it's good to know that option is there as well. And you can use it in your classes. So some other stuff, just some miscellaneous stuff in Groovy which can be used. So let's create a new Groovy script. If you create a collection and you want to have an immutable collection, I've shown you before, if you use s immutable on a collection, you will get an immutable collection. But there's also a tuple class available in Groovy. And let's say like this. I now have actually a new collection with three elements, and the collection is automatically immutable made by Groovy. So I can print this out, but I also, for example, I want to add an element. That should not be possible. So when I run this, it should throw an exception. That's the wrong one. Yeah. There we go. It should give me this one. So first, this is a print line of the values of my tuple collection, actually. And when I invoke the add method, you can see it's an unsupported operation. Also, I cannot remove elements from it. I cannot change the values. So that's quite useful to do. If you have a tuple of only two elements, it has its own type, which is tuple 2, which only takes two elements of a certain type. So I can just say 1 and 1. And also, to get to those values, I can say first, and there's this print line per second. So the first and second properties are added to make sure you can access the first or the second element of your tuple. Oh, there. That should work. So that works. Also, there's an implicit operator on classes which is available in Groovy, which is a call method. And let's create a nice, just to stay in the same theme. And I can implement the call method and, for example, give it a string value and do something with it. And I can say, this value, I want to show everything, so toString, include names is true. Import it, and of course there's already a user somewhere in my other scripts, and now it's not, so that's okay. So now I can create a new user object. Let's say user, that's the username, and by just implementing this call method, I have now a nice way of invoking my method just using this square bracket. So on my object instance, I can now just invoke the object instance, actually. So this could also be very handy if you're writing, for example, DSL and you want to do some funky stuff here. So in this case, I'm just actually invoking my object using this parentheses and providing it an argument. Could also provide a def call implementation without arguments, for example. And and then should be able to say, for example, user, and remove this. And it should execute my call method here, which is quite nice, actually. Also, for example, if you provide it a closure argument, you can even configure your object instance this way quite easily if you want to do it. Another thing I want to show is, if you write code in Groovy and you write Groovy scripts, the code gets compiled into a class file. You can customize the Groovy compiler. So if you specify a certain Groovy script for it, you can have certain rules that can be applied to it. I have an example here already. It's a file called Groovy compile. This is not so, otherwise it gets too confusing. So this is actually a script file that is executed when we compile a Groovy source file. And one of the implicit variables added to the script file is the configuration variable, which is actually a compiler configuration object. And I can invoke methods on it. For example, I can add compilation customizers, and that allows me to add, for example, in this case, I want to add a compile static annotation to every Groovy class file without typing it in every Groovy class file by just configuring it as a compiler configuration option. When I now want to compile my Groovy source files, it will automatically have compile static added to it. Another example of what you can do, for example, is add an implicit import. Groovy already adds a lot of stuff implicitly for you, packages like Java util package. But also, if I want to use Java time stuff, I want to have that included as well. It's an invisible import, actually. I can do the same thing using this configuration at the compilation customizer, in this case, just adding java.time.star for everything. And I can even go a bit further. For example, I can define expression checkers. In this case, this is a checker that checks if the variable name is only one character long. It will be rejected and the source file will not be compiled. So at compile time, I already have some kind of rule checking, which allows me to not even compile the source file and have to make sure that all the variables I define in my scripts and code are at least two characters long. So we have this expression checker defined here. It's added to the configuration via the secure AST customizer. And the secure AST customizer has a lot of methods available. We can add, for example, also whitelist statements. We can blacklist statements. We can blacklist certain expression tokens. A lot of stuff you can do here. You can even define that closures can be allowed or not, the method definitions are allowed or not by the code you write. So a lot of stuff you can change here. So the code you see here is just actually plain code, but this compiler configuration stuff also has its own DSL. And what we saw before is now the same thing we see here as a DSL, actually. So the withconfig method has a configuration option, and then in the closure we have this way of defining the same definition we saw in the code earlier on. So let's write a script that will not be able to compile. So let's write a Groovy script. It's called compile run. I should be able to now say instant.now because I had added this as an implicit import actually to my script. Let's see if that works. So let's I will go to the command line for this. Just to make it bigger. So there's this demo. Let's see where I stored my stuff. There's the source. When I run Groovy, I have this config script and this compile Groovy, and I had this compile run.groovy thing. So this is the output of the print line of instant.now. So although I did not add it as an import in my script, because I defined it in this compile config.groovy file, it's still added to it. And at compile time, it's added to it. And it can be used. Also, let's now do something that's not allowed. So I can say, I want to have this variable printed, but it's only one character long, so that should not be possible. Let's see what happens. So wow, it does not even compile, there's an error. It's a compilation error, startup failed. It does say that a certain variable expression is not allowed because it's not long enough. That's what we defined in this expression checker. So, it's really powerful, and there's a lot of stuff you can do here. And even the things you, for example, used in CodeNarc, you can also, for example, now use that kind of things before stuff is even compiled, or just used by the compiler itself. So a lot of things you can do in Groovy and the compiler. And one final thing I want to show, which is something I just crossed a while ago, while browsing through the source code of Groovy, and which I missed, apparently. There's something called a file tree builder in Groovy, which is quite a nice way to generate file structures. So there's this file tree builder available. And I can say, for example, there's a file tree builder that has a directory source, and it should be directory, well, let's call it docs. And there should be, oh, that's my indentation. should be a file that's called readme. And it has the ASCII.doctor extension, and then write something in there. So, for example, readme. Let's run this. Oh, sorry, the wrong one. Let's run the correct version. So now I should have a source directory. Where it is? Yeah. So there's now the source doc directory, which has a file readme dot, and the same context right here. So very powerful. Could be even better if we could write, for example, something like this. And say there's, for example, also a notes document. And instead of providing a closure to write the contents, I can also have a string value. Let's call it notes. That's nice to have this in lowercase. Let's run the application again. And now it should generate also a notes document quite easily. Which I thought was quite nice. It's also there in Groovy, just hidden somewhere in between all the other source code and stuff, Groovy, cool Groovy stuff that's available. So any questions? And otherwise, just look at my blog and see what's out there, other Groovy stuff. So I'd like to thank you for attention and for spending your time here at GreatConf. I'll see you next time.